I want to start with this gravitational wave astronomy, and you all know the detectors that now are observing the sky, that are the two LIGO antenna and Virgo in Cascina. And we have a new player in this network that is Kagra. So Kagra started to observe very recently, and I will show you the importance to increase the network for the sky localization. And I want to come back really a few years ago and to the first detection of LIGO and Virgo. LIGO, this was only by LIGO in reality. So this was the first binary black hole observed in gravitational waves. And in this plot, I think there is all what is the electromagnetic follow-up. So here you can see that a big sky localization, this the main challenge for the electromagnetic follow-up. And you can see the network of electromagnetic observatory that observed this very big sky localization. So I think that this plot showed that the astronomical community was ready to this type of search, even if there are a lot of challenges, but show also what are the challenges, and mainly, for example, in the optical band, where in this very big sky localization, you have many, many contaminants. So it's not really easy to detect the electromagnetic counterpart, and the high energy can help a lot from this point of view. So for this event, we had also this weak transient in gamma ray, so it was not confirmed by other satellites. So I think that we really, it's difficult to say that this was a counterpart. And but in any case, these stimulate a lot of also exotic models in which there could be some high energy emission associated with binary black hole. Oops, it seems. Okay, let's go. Okay, second run. So the fantastic detection of a binary neutron star, the detection of the gamma ray satellites of Fermi and Integral, and the very extensive observational campaign in the electromagnetic band. So the detection of the kilonova, the X-ray emission, the radio emission, and observation that lasts almost 3 years. And this event had a big impact in many fields. So we know better the shape, the structure of relativistic jet. We know better kilonovae, nucleosynthesis in the universe. We are starting to put constraint using gravitational wave on the equation of state of neutron star. Again, there is some issue. And we show that there is also a new way to make cosmology, even if to make cosmology, we really need a lot of detection. This was only to show that this is possible, but we need a lot of joint detection. So we talk about tens, to have precise cosmology, tens of joint detection. And also we start also to know better what is the channel of formation of compact object. Now I want to go to what was first run, second run, and half of the third run for this advanced detector. So here you can see the event rate. And so you can see the big increase of event rate going from 1 to 0.3a. And this is related to the upgrade in sensitivity that we have. So we have run of observation that are stopped to make technological upgrade to increase the sensitivity, and then the run start again. And each step of sensitivity corresponds to a larger volume in which we detect this rare event. And so starting from 3 events in 1, we had 39 candidate events in about 6 months in 3. So I want to tell you that this 39th candidate has have a false alarm rate of 2 per year. So this means that in this sample of candidate, we expect a contamination fraction of about 10%. So about 3-4 of these sources are likely to be noise. So this is the plot in which I can show you all the detection that it's really very impressive. So this is a 1, this is a 2, and this is a 3. So from the point of view of binary black hole, we really know better. So all the properties, the mass, the frequency of this merger of binary black holes, and some hints also on the channel of formation. In this plot, you can see the total mass versus the mass ratio. And I want to show you some specific events that I think are really interesting. So first of all, we detected a second binary neutron star merger. So we detect an event that from the point of view of the masses is can be classified as neutron star black hole, but this is a very is one of these events that have a very, very high fast alarm rate. That means that probably we are not sure that is a real event. Then we detected a source for which we don't know if it is a neutron star black hole or a low mass binary black hole. And another interesting one was the first detection of an intermediate massive black hole. And they go more in details. So this is the second detection of a binary neutron star merger. I want to immediately tell you this source is at larger distance with respect to GV170817, 160 megaparsec. And there was no detection of an electromagnetic counterpart. And what is the reason? The reason was the sky localization mainly. So the sky localization of this source was really huge. So in this case, to find an electromagnetic counterpart, if there is not an high energy source, is almost impossible. Then the source of August of the last year. So here we detected a object, a system in which we have a black hole and a source of 2.6 solar masses. So these sources, from the point of view through the gravitational wave, we are not able to say if this source, the smaller component, is a neutron star or is a black hole. So from the point of view of the sky localization, the sky localization was extremely good, so 20 square degrees. But so first of all, from the gravitational waves, no evidence of tidal effects in the gravitational wave signal and no electromagnetic counterpart. This is consistent with both scenarios. So it's consistent with a binary black hole, but also with a neutron star black hole. Because in the case of the neutron star black hole, this can be explained by the large mass ratio. Because here we have a very big black hole and the neutron star, if it is a neutron star, and the neutron star fall down in the black hole without being disrupted. And this means no material around to have the electromagnetic counterpart. So we are really not able to say if this object, also using gravitational wave and the electromagnetic part, if it is a neutron star or a black hole. I want to show you that in any case, there was a very extensive campaign, and this is the electromagnetic campaign, the optical campaign that was done by the ENGRAVE group that observed the region, the small region, the small sky localization with the wide field of view telescope, but also with a small telescope using a galaxy targeting similar to the one that was used for GV170817. And in this plot, you can see that we had constrain upper limit able to constrain kilonova emission. And but we don't detect, and the reason is in the mass ratio if this system is a neutron star black hole system. So the other one was this intermediate massive black hole, extremely interesting. So this was the first intermediate massive black hole, 140 solar masses. We didn't know about the existence of this black hole before. And also the components are really very massive. They are in the peristability gap. And so it seems that all these objects, the component and the final intermediate mass black hole come from a hierarchical scenario in which these black hole forms from the merger of lighter black hole. So there is a scenario in which this binary system, the rate of this binary system, can the rate of merger of binary black hole system can increase when they are in an AGN, so in the disk of an AGN. And associated to this scenario, there was a detection of ZTF, a flare, very nearby to an AGN, 30 days after the GV event. And so there was this hypothesis that this could be the counterpart of this binary black hole in the optical. I have to say that I am a bit skeptical about this scenario, but in any case, we will see the future if we will have other observations similar to this one. So the other sources that seems to be a neutron star black hole. So the, we think that could be a neutron star black hole on the basis of the masses of the sources, but also in this case, the data, we didn't see tidal effects, mainly because the data were uninformative about this. This is a very high signal to noise, a very high false alarm rate, as I told you. So this is likely a noise event. And also in this case, there was no electromagnetic detection. Also in this case, the sky localization was pretty big. So 1000 square degree. And also an object that is distant because it was about 400 megaparsec. So I want to say you a bit about what will be the future only also because of Hermes. So what will be the next run? So we will have improving on the sensitivity. Currently, the LIGO and Virgo detector are in a phase of upgrade, also CAGRA. And we expect so this increase of sensitivity 404 and then 405. So the next run, looking at this plot, seems to start before 2022, but I want to say you that a few days ago, LIGO Lab announced that the O4 run will not start before June 2022. Virgo will take the decision next week, but we are pretty sure that it will be aligned to the date of LIGO. So I think that we have not to expect a run that start before June 2022. Here in this plot, you can see some number. This number is the range of a binary neutron star system. And you can see that you have improvement on the range. And in O5, the volume observed by this network will be 15 times larger than the volume observed in O3. In this table, you can see the improvement in the range also for different sources. So this is a binary neutron star, this is a binary black hole, this is a neutron star black hole, and this range corresponds to this fixed mass. And this is also the range for bursts, for sources for which we assume an energy emitted in gravitational waves. And then we say, okay, this is the maximum range up to which we can see this object. And in particular, this is in the last row, you can see energy that we expected emitted for supernovae. And you can see that LIGO and Virgo and CAGRA will observe supernovae inside our galaxy. So this is what we expect for O4 and O5. This range corresponds to a signal to noise ratio in each detector equal to 8. So this is our prediction for the sky localization. And you can see here how much improved from O3 to O4 the sky localization. And this is mainly because we expect Kagra observing with LIGO in Virgo, and because there is an improvement of LIGO in Virgo sensitivity, but mainly because we expect a big improvement in the Kagra sensitivity. So in this plot, you can see the this is again the sky localization, this is the luminosity distance distribution that we expect, and this is also the volume. And here we expect an improvement in the volume that is associated to the improvement in the sky localization. This is the volume uncertainty. So what is the volume corresponding to our signal? It's very useful because it gives you also an idea of how many galaxies are inside this volume if you want to make a targeting search. To say this plot in numbers, so you can see here the improvement of the sky localization going from 03 to 04, I have to say that these numbers are I think a bit optimistic. We did this simulation using the most optimistic sensitivity for 04. And so take this as the most optimistic scenarios. But in any case, you see that the sky localization will reduce from 100 of square degree to tens of square degree. And in particular, about 40% of binary neutron star are expected to be detected with a sky localization smaller than 20 square degree. So this simulation that I showed you before were done using what we knew about from 01 and 02. Now we have also 03A, and so we change a bit our knowledge of this population. In particular, for the binary black hole, we know really better also the distribution of mass, and also the rate. And so we have a constraint on the rate that is pretty good, and also we can also estimate this detection rate also on the basis of a better knowledge of the mass. And we are working on this. And then also for the binary neutron star, we have a new rate, a new astrophysical merger rate. This is based only on two detections. So, but it changed a bit and we are going to smaller value with respect to what we predicted in O1 and O2. So I show you the detection rate that we obtain with the old simulation because we are working on the new simulation using also the O3 data. The prediction for O4 is to have 10 of binary neutron star detections. I want to show you a comparison of the O3 prediction with respect to with what we observed in 6 months. So the top plot, the top table is 1 year. This is 6 months, and there is a difference between the two that I have to underline, that this is obtained for a signal to noise ratio larger than 12, and this is a signal to noise ratio larger than 8. So you need to, when you compare these two numbers, you need to keep attention because there is this difference in the signal to noise ratio. I want to give you a rough number. So we are making the real simulation, but if we use so the same signal to noise ratio and the new astrophysical rate, we can confirm the S median about 10, even if this 52 is reduced a lot. And for the binary black hole, we expect around 100. So these are the numbers that we expect for 04 for the optimistic sensitivity that I showed you before. I want to say something also about the third generation of detector. And in particular, in Europe, we have the Einstein telescope. And recently, we submitted this free proposal, and we will have the results of this during the summer of 2022. And if we will be part of this free roadmap, this means really that Europe keep a step forward to the Einstein telescope. So Einstein telescope will be something that is very realistic. And the plan is that it will start observation in 2035. So this telescope, this observatory has a factor 10 better sensitivity with respect to the 2G detector. And also is very good at low frequency. So we can try to reach really low frequency around 1 hertz, few hertz. Another effort is in United States is Cosmic Explorer. The concept is a bit different. So Einstein telescope is a triangle. This one is an L. Einstein telescope is underground. This is very similar to LIGO. So what is the future? So Einstein telescope will allow us really to observe almost all the observable universe, at least for binary black hole. And really we will have a big increase of detection of these compact object systems, and we will be able to observe them along the cosmic history of the universe. And I show you what is LIGO and Virgo and what will be Einstein Telescope and Cosmic Explorer. So we are really in a situation in which we can study primordial black hole. We can try to understand if binary black hole come from POP3, intermediate massive black hole, a link to the star formation history, and follow this the binary neutron star and the GRB also at high redshift. I want to give you the number. So the number is detection that we expect are around 10 to the 5 neutron star merger per year. So really, I think this will be a big step forward with respect to LIGO and Virgo, the current network. So why high energies is so important? If we take the optical band, and if you look at this plot, you can see that already LSST will be difficult to observe to, in this case is 500 megaparsecs or 1 gigaparsec. So in the optical band, the counterpart became really too faint. Again, with the third generation of detector, we will deal again with the large sky localization and many contaminants. And so really in the optical band, I think that the joint detection of these third generation of detector and will be really limited, the joint detection by the optical instruments, not from the gravitational wave side, but we are really limited by the capability of the optical instruments and the fact that the sources are really very faint. This is the sky localization. This is a preliminary work done by Stefan Grimm here at the JSSI. And this is done using an astrophysical simulation of a binary neutron star. This is 1 year of observation. And you can see that Einstein telescope in 1 year will be able to observe alone 10 to the 3, also more, in this case 10 to the 3 up to 0.2 2 as redshift. And so big number of detection, but this is Einstein telescope alone, and you can see that the sky localization will be pretty bad. It improved within so this volume of the universe. So in the local universe, so we can say that if Einstein telescope will be able to observe with the network of current detector, we will have a large number of sources detected with a sky localization smaller than 10 square degrees. This is at the simulation at larger redshift. This is a week of observation. So big numbers really in a week of observation. And here again, Einstein telescope alone will not be able to localize the sources. Einstein telescope and Cosmic Explorer, again, we have a good number of detection with a good sky localization. So at larger redshift, if we will have only one detector, and we expect this at least at the beginning, the sky localization, so the sky localization will be only if we will have gamma ray burst, because to have a precise localization, to have all the follow-up, so to make really all the study that allow us also to make cosmology, to study the also binary neutron star emission mechanism, need all the follow-up observation, and we need a sky localization. So the GRB here can be crucial to have all the electromagnetic counterpart detected. So here I want also to talk a bit about a study that we did here. So here with the collaborators.
Sorry, Marika, can you finish in 2 minutes?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I am very rapid. So this is a work in which we explain the X-ray plateau observed by SWIFT by structured jet. And I want to show you this plot that was done by a work driven by Stefano Scienzi. And here is this, we explain the plateau of GRB in X-ray using the high latitude emission. What you can see here is that if we go off axis, we can have a promising X-ray counterpart in the soft X-ray also for Hermes. Here you can see what we expect for different viewing angle for objects that are at the LIGO and Virgo range, ET range, and here is a GRB more distant. This is the sensitivity of Theseus. This is the sensitivity of Rosetta, so I can think that we can put a line also here for Hermes. And I think this is very promising because this plot showed that in the first hours, this emission is pretty bright to be observed. And okay, this is the last slide. This is the future. Many observatories, and I think that Hermes is really very crucial, will be very a key player in this scenario. Sorry if I was taking too much time.
No, perfect, thanks. Sorry, we are